Send your children out to renew themselves. Send them to regain in the open field the strength lost in the foul air of our crowded cities. So wrote the philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau, a man who played a major part in the emergence of the romantic sensibility of the late 18th century. Man was born in a pure state, Rousseau claimed, but it was corrupted by society. Therefore, a truly good, just society could only be created through immersion in the unspoiled world of nature. And you see in late 18th century society, but the arts in particular, this growing preoccupation with the beauties of nature. And much of this was a reaction against the increasing industrialization throughout Europe as a result of, what else? The Industrial Revolution. And one of the most fascinating examples of this return to nature was the Arcadian phenomena, sort of a collective longing among 18th century French society, especially the nobility. An obsession, really, with the mythical paradise on earth of Greek antiquity. And as expected, this sense of longing inspired a major genre of artistic expression in art, poetry, literature, and music. And again, we turn to the operas and ballets of Jean-Philippe Rameau, whose music we heard at the beginning, most of which are set in this mythical pastoral dream world, where, oddly enough, we sense an austere, grave, almost morose sadness and beauty. I still don't know quite what to make of this unearthly music, but I think that it must capture, like a time capsule, a decadent and doomed society's yearning for an unattainable utopian vision. Fortunately, Beethoven's relationship with nature was healthy and life-affirming, as we will see. No one can love the country as much as I do, he wrote, for surely woods, trees, and rocks produce the echo that man desires to hear. And the fact that Beethoven composed his exquisite Sixth Symphony essentially in tandem with the dark, dramatic Fifth only increases its profoundly joyous, exalted quality. And as I revisited this work, having known it since 1962, something very important and obvious became apparent, and it has to do with the crucial element of harmony. Having just left the mighty Fifth Symphony, where once again we heard Beethoven's frequent use of the fundamental tonic and dominant chords, now we're going to add another chord. And once again, these chords are identified not only by name or term, like tonic and dominant, but also for easy reference by number. So the tonic chord is 1, because it's built on the first note of the scale. Say in C major, there's 1, and there's your home key. That's the 1 chord. The dominant note, G, is the 5 chord, because G is the 5th note up from C. 1, 2, 3, 4, there's your G. There's your 5 chord. So the continual repetition of these two chords in musicians' lingo is referred to as the 1-5-1 progression. So let's add another basic chord now to complete the holy trinity of harmony. It's the 4 chord, and it's built on the 4th note of the scale. 1-2-3, there it is, you know. 1-2-3-1, 4-3-2. Yes. And the 4 chord is called the subdominant because it's 1 note lower than the dominant. So here in C major, here's the 1 chord, the tonic. Here's G major, the dominant, the 5 chord. And here's F major, the subdominant, the 4 chord. And this subdominant 4 chord is extremely important in tonal music, and it's very familiar. 4-1-5-1 or 1-4. first movement of the Beethoven First Symphony. 4-1-5. And this subdominant chord is very prominent in liturgical music. So you'll see where all of this is going. So let's switch now back to F major, okay? It's our tonic chord, F. The subdominant chord, the four chord, is here. The dominant is here, and the tonic. So here is a liturgical hymn. There, the four chord, very familiar sound. Or let's take a hymn-like anthem. There it is. Here it is again. And once more. And there's great positive life-affirming energy in this progression. Tonic, subdominant, dominant. Yes, so now switching gears slightly. And that repeating bass line. Hear the baritone sax honking it out. This would make a great passacaglia if the melody went off into lots of variations. That was Da Do Ran Ran by the Crystals from 1963, one of the 10 greatest hits from the 1960s. I don't know what the other nine are, but that's definitely one of them. Life is just so much better with the subdominant chord. Boom, boom, etc. And that great spot in Beethoven's Fifth Symphony in the second movement near the end where the strings were always playing. Remember, and I made a big deal about this, how the last time Beethoven does and it really blossoms. That's the subdominant chord with lots of appoggiaturas on top. That's why that passage is so glorious. And speaking of popular, inspiring music of mid-18th century England, were we? Well, at any rate, you would never want to hear the Hallelujah Chorus harmonized like this. Right? No. That's the five chord, the dominant chord. It must have the subdominant chord. There it is. My goodness. In fact, the traditional amen at the end of hymns consists of two chords. The subdominant chord and the tonic chord. So, getting back to F major, the key of Beethoven's sixth. You see how we circle around here and get back to our main work. We would have amen, subdominant, the four chord, and one. And the softening effect of the subdominant chord is present in a major way in Beethoven's sixth. So the sixth symphony begins with that most bucolic sound in the violas and celli, the open fifth. My script says, insert joke here. Open fifth is simply the interval of a fifth, because the two notes are five notes apart. There they are. And it's open because there are no other notes to complicate things. And over this open fifth, a lovely, graceful tune in the violins. And this theme contained two prominent cells. Yes, there it is, another four-note motif from Beethoven at this period. Along with this. And a moment later, this variant of it. I will call this the motif. Da-da-da-da. And this motif, with its two fleeting 16th notes, da-da-da, it essentially becomes the of this first movement, since Beethoven derives so much of his material from this. And already in the very first measure of the symphony, even though there's very little harmony to accompany the theme, there is a clear implication of the subdominant, the four chord, in this. And as the theme continues, the violas provide more harmony, which confirms the subdominant feel. And now these strings all align vertically in a distinctly hymn-like phrase. There it is, the four chord, the subdominant chord. So, in the first 15 measures of the symphony, the beauty and the joy of the countryside is definitely but subtly shaded with a sense of reverence by the use of these hymn-like progressions. And immediately, the motive takes over completely, and the motive is repeated 10 times. Count them. And the many repetitions of the motive have led to that jolly oboe melody, which is our main theme from the opening. With the open fifth now very active in the celli. But I can't go on now without mentioning that persistent use of the motive, which repeatedly leads us to the dominant C major, which repeats 10 times unchanged. The bassoons add in for one bar. The motive crescendos, and then it fades. It's a striking way to build a motive into a larger section of the overall structure, repeating it 10 times. In any case, we now hear the hearty main theme played by the full orchestra in its full extended version. And the clarinets and bassoons, the sounds of nature echoing. And the theme's first measure, then, the first four notes, da-da-da-da-da, they're now extended gently by the violins. And this same motive now becomes a transition, centering around the note G, like so. Four-note motive, ba-ba-ba-bum, leading directly now to our secondary theme in the dominant key of C major. It's calm and flowing, and it's built entirely on the dominant and the tonic harmonies, and the sense of motion provided by the strings creates a magical, shimmery effect that builds momentum until the joy can't be contained any longer. And that exuberant new theme is built on the motive. Da-da-dum, da-da-dum, but it's in C major, but it cadences gently on F, the subdominant chord. And the oboes continue now in thirds. 4, 1, 5, 1. And it's not that Beethoven didn't use the subdominant chord before this. Of course he did. It's just that it becomes so much more prominent in this work. And it's a major reason for this symphony's emotional warmth. And now a vigorous closing theme in C major. And again, it's built on the rhythm of the motive. Da-da-dum, da-da-dum. And the winds, they're in big octaves. And the descending interval, the fourth, the descending fourth, prominently associated with the sounds of nature. In fact, in Mahler's first symphony, he used the descending fourth, and he marked it in the score, wie ein Naturlaut, like a sound of nature. So here is Beethoven's vigorous closing theme and the motive in a continuous stream of sound in the low strings with the violin's nature sounds. Thank you. And the motive now leads us through a transition into the key of B flat major, like so. As our development section settles into that key, Beethoven simply takes the motive, da-da-dum-da, but in its descending version that we heard in the opening. Now in B flat major, there's the motive descending. And he repeats it continually over a sustained B flat major chord in the winds and horns with an active accompaniment in the violas and celli. And this accompaniment simply outlines B flat major triads, but it's in a gentle triple rhythm. And because this intersects with the duplet rhythm of the theme, one and two and one and two, we have a rhythmic device that we call two against three that would become an essential component of the music of Johannes Brahms decades later. But here is this magnificent passage entirely based on rhythmic motion and the repetition of and a single magical shift of harmony from B flat major into radiant D major. And Beethoven's development section continues with standalone repetitions of the motive. And then higher. Then. And he extracts then, as he often does, just two notes. Naturlaut, as Mahler would say. Sounds of nature. Calling. Answering. Maybe it's a cuckoo. Two things about the passage we've just heard. First, the construction, the architecture of the music creates this magnificent expanse with mostly literal repeats. And at a precise moment in its progress through time, it changes to, and it continues to amplify in volume and breadth of sound. And we think of Beethoven's verbal description, the heading of this first movement, cheerful impressions upon arriving in the countryside. Mehr Ausdruck der Empfindungen, he added, more expression of feeling than of painting. So it's not a direct description of anything, but it's an exalted emotional vista that's captured in sound. And second, and I know I'm repeating myself, but Beethoven's technique of motivic, organic development of his themes, the way he can extract a few notes from the theme, and then spin them out, creating new variants that evolve into new shapes that are used to build new sections of the overall structure. This technique absolutely parallels the process of growth and development in nature, the patterns by which living organisms expand. Usually it's quite intricate, but here it's a precisely determined number of repetitions of a single motive that gradually expands into this magnificent arch. And the best part of all of this is that this entire passage will now repeat in G major. And an even more magical shift at that same point now into radiant E major. And there, that brief hymn-like progression in A major. And now the development continues using this hymn phrase, but now in G minor. it moves into a brilliant C major, then back to F major, the tonic key, but with a major arrival point on the subdominant B flat major, like so. Second violins, violas, celli. There's a delicate cadenza now for the first violins in the dominant of C major. And the music flows now without fanfare into the recapitulation, one of the loveliest passages in the entire work. And it features that triplet figuration that we heard from the development section in the low strings, that thing, now returns, but it's in the first violins and it's over the main theme, like so. And this obbligato is as gentle as it is expressive until it begins to intensify and build momentum as duple rhythm, the motive, and triple rhythm now combine and lead us back to our joyous main theme. Here is the entire passage. And the recapitulation follows the events of the exposition, now all in the tonic F major. And just as before, the music will die away with nature sounds and the motive in the celli. And again, we have the same brief interlude that led to the development section. Built on this F7 chord, a sure sign that we're headed for the key of B flat major, just as we heard in the development. But now, change of plans. An unexpected, robust statement of the main theme by the full string section and French horns. And decisively in the key of B flat major, the subdominant key, another great moment in this symphony. And now we've emerged into a shimmery pastoral vision. That's our closing theme, formerly very vigorous. But now the rhythm of the motive, ba-da-dum, ba-da-dum, is much more tranquil and relaxed. With a background of strings and octaves, and this closing theme in B-flat major now crescendos into a glorious, expansive passage, almost hymn-like in its grandeur and in the tonic F major. It subsides, and the motive that now returns, but very lively. Beethoven, always searching for new ways of using the cells of his themes, he takes the motive and he gives us a mini concert by a two-man peasant band, with this new rhythm based on the motive. It's just the clarinet and bassoon, complete with peasant piping by the clarinet. And another famous orchestral audition excerpt is born, the clarinet passage. And the tranquility now, the silence, the majesty of nature reigns as the main theme is extended upward into the celestial blue, as it were. The flute the clarinet and bassoon. And this upward scale, it's a slightly simplified version of the motif that we heard before. But now, and it clearly outlines the subdominant tonality, B flat major, which in my opinion continues to highlight the hymn-like character of this music, especially in light of Beethoven's own words.